Good morning, dear students. Today's topic is pericardium, and here is the heart. So already gross features of heart is over. So I'm going to directly explain about the pericardium. So first, the definition of the pericardium. Pericardium, it is the fibrocerous layer which is covering the heart, similar to the pleura. And this fibrocerous layer, it is protective covering for the heart, not only heart and also the beginning of the great vessels. So this fibrocerous sac, it covers the heart as well as beginning of the great vessels, that is aorta, pulmonary trunk, superior vena cava, inferior vena cava, and the four pulmonary veins, right pulmonary veins and left pulmonary veins. So these structures it is covering. Next, location, where is the pericardium located? So pericardium is located in the middle mediastinum. So this is the middle mediastinum. So in front of the middle mediastinum, here we have anterior mediastinum, posterior mediastinum. So in the middle mediastinum, between the two lungs, there is pericardium. So this pericardium, it is located behind the body of the sternum, from manubriosternal joint to the xiphoid process or xiphosternal joint, behind the body of sternum and costal cartilages and with respect to the thoracic vertebra, it is situated in front of T4 to T8, situated in front of T4 to T8 thoracic vertebra. So it is situated in the middle mediastinum, between the two lungs, behind the body of the sternum and costal cartilages, and in front of T4 to T8 thoracic vertebra. This is regarding the location of the pericardium. Next, function. So what are the functions of the pericardium? So pericardium has some few important functions, like it is protecting the heart, it is preventing the infection to the heart, it is maintaining the stability of the heart in the middle mediastinum. So cardiac stability is maintained by pericardium here inside. It protects the heart, it prevents the infection, and because of the presence of the pericardium, ventricular filling and atrial filling of are possible, because pericardium maintains the hydrostatic pressure as well as intracardiac pressures. So maintaining these two pressures, it leads to maintenance of that is filling of ventricular as well as atrial blood. Next, layers. What are the layers? So we told it is a fibrocerous structure. So fibrous layer will be there as well as serous layer will be there. So two layers. Fibrous layer is the outermost covering of the pericardium. Next is serous layer, which is present inside the fibrous layer, and serous layer again has two layers, parietal layer and visceral layer. Parietal layer, which is present deep to the fibrous layer, and visceral layer, which is present deep to the parietal layer. So from outside inside, we will have fibrous layer of pericardium, parietal serous layer, visceral serous layer, and then heart. So visceral serous layer, it is also called epicardium. It is also called epicardium, and it is very close to the surface of heart. So these are about the layers. Now we will go into detail about the fibrous pericardium. So what is fibrous pericardium? So it is the outermost covering. It consists of dense collagenous fibers, and these fibers are arranged in three layers, and in 120 degrees direction they are arranged, each layer with opposite layer, it is arranged in 120 degrees, and it is very dense and protective. It is tough, it is not elastic. So this fibrous layer, it covers the heart as well as beginning of the great vessels, that is aorta, pulmonary trunk, superior vena cava, inferior vena cava, pulmonary veins, 1, 2, 3, 4 pulmonary veins. So fibrous layer covers the heart as well as all these great vessels, excluding the inferior vena cava. So inferior vena cava doesn't receive any covering of the fibrous pericardium. So this is the covered structures. Then composition, I have told you already, it is composed of dense collagenous fibers in three layers arranged in 120 degrees direction. And then this pericardium has cardiac seat belt. So seat belt, usually we use it for stability. So in order to maintain the cardiac, that is heart, in position in the mediastinum, the heart is binded on all sides so that it doesn't move by means of pericardium. So how it is bound? So what are the cardiac seat belt structures? So what happens is, pericardium, which is covering the heart, encroaching or onto the surface of the beginning of the great vessels, it also attaches to the adventitia of all the great vessels above. It attaches to the adventitia of great vessels above. Anteriorly, it is attached to the sternum by means of superior and inferior sternopericardial ligaments. So anteriorly, it is maintaining stability by attachment to the sternopericardial ligaments. Above, it is maintaining stability by fusing with the adventitia of great vessels as well as the deep cervical fascia. So prevertebral fascia, we have already learnt it. So inferiorly, it merges with the pericardium. So pericardium is attached to the prevertebral fascia of pretracheal fascia of deep cervical fascia. So this is anterior stability. This is superior stability. And inferiorly, we have the diaphragm here. So on the surface of the diaphragm, heart is situated. So this pericardium, it attaches to the central tendon of diaphragm. So diaphragm in the middle, it is having a tendon. So this tendon is called central tendon of diaphragm. So pericardium is attached to the central tendon of diaphragm. Central tendon of diaphragm and the pericardium together develop from septum transversum. This is the reason why pericardium is attached to the central tendon of diaphragm. Okay, so how? Three seat belts. One is anteriorly, sternopericardial ligaments. One is pretracheal fascia from above and also the adventitia. And another one is central tendon below. So these three bindings to the pericardium maintains the cardiac stability. So that's why it is called cardiac seat belt. So it acts as a cardiac seat belt. Then next, relations. What are the structures which are present in front, behind, on either sides of pericardium? So heart is situated here. So what will be there in front? Sternum is there. Between the sternum and the heart, we will see encroachment of pleura as well as lung. So lung, which is covered by pleura, anterior border of lung and pleura together, they are present anteriorly between sternum and the pericardium. As usually we told, sternopericardial ligaments, they are present anteriorly. Thymus, before it regresses, it is also seen in the anterior, seen anterior to the pericardium. So these are the structures which are present anteriorly. That is pleura, lung, sternopericardial ligaments, thymus. Then next, posteriorly, what are the structures which are present? So posteriorly, posterior mediastinal structures. So what are the structures we see in the posterior mediastinum? Esophagus, thoracic aorta, azygous vein, hemiazygous vein, and posterior intercostal arteries here on either side, and posterior part of lung. So on either side, we will see the lung. So posterior part of the mediastinal surface of the lung, these are related posterior. So once again, posterior relations, esophagus, descending thoracic aorta, azygous vein, hemiazygous vein, thoracic duct, and posterior part of mediastinal surface of lung. So these are the posterior relations. And laterally, so laterally on either side we will have the lung. Laterally on either side we will have the lung. So mediastinal surface of the lung is the lateral relation. That is mediastinal surface or mediastinal pleura. Mediastinal pleura, which covers the mediastinal surface of lung. This will be on either side. And we also see the phrenic nerve. Phrenic nerve, which is going from this cervical region. So phrenic nerve, which is coming from the cervical region. So it passes to the diaphragm. So meanwhile, it is related to the lateral aspect of pericardium. That is, it is between the mediastinal pleura and pericardium. So here also pericardiophrenic vessels also will be there laterally. So laterally mediastinal pleura and lung, phrenic nerve and pericardiophrenic vessels, all these will be there laterally. So these are the relations, these are the relations of fibrous pericardium. Then coming to the serous pericardium. So serous pericardium, it is the serous sac which is enclosing the heart deep to the fibrous layer. So here you can see, so this black one is the fibrous pericardium. This is the diaphragm, central tendon of diaphragm. And this pink color one is the serous pericardium. So parietal layer of serous pericardium. Then next comes to the serous visceral layer of serous pericardium. So here you can see one thing, heart is present outside the serous bag, outside the serous bag, and it is present inside the fibrous bag, inside the fibrous bag. So heart is intrafibrous, extra serous. Intrafibrous and extra serous. Suppose we take the fibrous layer like this, heart is situated inside like this covering. But serous bag, it's not like that. During development, serous bag is like a ball like structure. So this ball like structure, it is invaded by the heart. So it is covered by the heart on all sides. So this is due to the dipping of the bag by the heart. So these two layers are formed, parietal layer and serous layer. So heart is extra serous and intra fibrous structure. So this is about the serous pericardium. So it has a parietal layer, a visceral layer. Visceral layer, it is also called epicardium. And in between the parietal layer and the serous layer, we have the pericardial cavity. So parietal layer lines the deep surface of the fibrous layer, and visceral serous layer, it lines the surface of heart. It lines the surface of heart. Visceral serous layer lines the surface of heart. Parietal serous layer lies deep to the fibrous layer. So this cavity which is present inside, this is called pericardial cavity. Normally pericardial cavity accumulates 15 to 20 ml of pericardial fluid. In some books it is given like 30 ml, but normal capacity is only up to 20 ml. In diseased conditions, it can launch only up to 300 ml of pericardial fluid. Beyond that, there will be problem. Beyond that, there will be problem. So pericardial cavity is nothing but it's the cavity which is present between parietal and serous layer of pericardium. Then next, there is some importance of this visceral layer. Visceral layer, it consists of mesothelial cells, and these cells have cilia. They help in the production of pericardial fluid. They help in the production of pericardial fluid. So surface of the visceral layer, it is covered by mesothelial cells. Deep to that, there will be subserosal connective tissue. Subserosal connective tissue. This subserosal connective tissue consists of fat and connective tissue. The importance here is that based on the amount of fat, we can assess the clinical things like heart attack. So you take the patients with metabolic syndrome like obesity and diabetic patients, and as the age increases also, these three things lead to increased accumulation of fat in the subserosal connective tissue. When there is more amount of fat in the subserosal connective tissue, there are more chances of heart attacks because of coronary blood vessels are present in this subserosal connective tissue. So coronary blood vessels, whatever right left coronary blood vessels, they are situated in the epicardium. So you can see the blood vessels here. So they are situated in the epicardium, that is visceral layer of the pericardium. So whatever fat which comes along with the blood vessels, it gets accumulated here, and this is one of the indications for heart attacks. So cardiometabolic risk factor. So this is one evidence for cardiometabolic risk factors. Then next, blood supply. So blood supply, arterial supply and venous drainage. Pericardium is supplied by internal thoracic artery. So we have seen internal thoracic artery here. So this internal thoracic artery, it supplies the pericardium, and it is also supplied by superior phrenic artery. So this is the diaphragm here. Superior phrenic artery will be there. It also supplies the lower part of the pericardium, and posterior aspects of the pericardium are supplied by intercostal arteries, posterior intercostal arteries, as well as some esophageal branches, and from branches from thoracic aorta, branches from thoracic aorta, branches from esophagus, posterior intercostal arteries, as well as superior phrenic artery. But 80% it is supplied by internal thoracic artery. This is the arterial supply. Venous drainage. So all this pericardium, it drains mainly into azygous system of vein. So posteriorly here we will see the hemiazygous azygous vein and hemiazygous vein. So all the pericardium, it drains into azygous and hemiazygous veins. So visceral layer, first it drains into the coronary sinus of the heart. So coronary sinus of the heart, here you can see here. So this is the coronary sinus, that is the large vein of the heart. So first visceral layer, it drains into the coronary sinus. Then all these veins, they finally drain into the azygous system of heart. So this is about the venous drainage. Then next, lymphatic drainage. So lymphatic drainage. So lymphatic drainage is drained by lymphatic plexus. So here we have two plexus, double plexus. Double lymphatic plexus will be there. So double layer, one is present in the pericardium, epipericardium, and second one, it is present outside the fibrous layer. So these lymphatics, they drain into thoracic duct. So on either side, we have only two main lymphatic ducts. So on the left side we have thoracic duct, right side we have right lymphatic duct. So pericardium drains into these two ducts, and it also drains into the lymph nodes, that is thoracic lymph nodes, cardiac lymph nodes, thoracic lymph nodes. So these are the, this is about the lymphatic drainage of heart. Then next, nerve supply. So nerve supply, parietal layer is supplied by phrenic nerve, that is fibrous layer. Fibrous layer is supplied by phrenic nerve. So since it is present most outside it is present. So phrenic nerve passing laterally, that supplies the fibrous layer, and in fibrous as well as parietal serous layer. Visceral layer is supplied by nerves supplying the heart. So what are the nerves supplying the heart? Sympathetic nervous system and parasympathetic is, that is vagus nerve. Sympathetic and parasympathetic. So sympathetic, from the sympathetic fluxes from the cervical, thoracic and stellate ganglion, they form the aortic lymphatic plexus as well as cardiac plexus. So they supply the visceral layer. And vagus nerve, parasympathetic, that supplies the visceral layer. So visceral layer is supplied by nerves from the heart, that is sympathetic from the cervical plexus, thoracic as well as stellate ganglion, they form the aortic plexus as well as cardiac plexus, that supplies the visceral layer. And from the vagus nerve, you will see the supply to the parasympathetic supply to visceral nerve. But parietal layer of serous pericardium as well as fibrous layer, both are supplied by phrenic nerve. So what is this supply for? So nerve supply is important to sensory nerve supply. So what we see here is pericardial pain. So when there is any infection or inflammation of pericardium, we will see pericardial pain. So this pain is very sharp. Pain is very sharp and it is severe. It is severe pain. And this pain increases with bending backwards or lying down, and it relieves by sitting forwards. So how is pericardial pain is? It is sharp, it is severe, and it increases with lying backwards and decreases with moving forwards. So this type of pain, when we see in any patients, we can, and it is present in the that pain is seen behind the sternum. That pain is seen behind the sternum or sternopericardial region. It is seen sternopericardial region. Sharp, severe sternopericardial pain, which is relieved by bending forwards and increased by moving backwards. We can suspect there is pericardial pain. Some people may have breathlessness also. So that is different aspect. So anyway, that is pericardial pain. So these 10 things are important about the anatomy of pericardium. Then next, we will see the pericardial sinuses. So pericardial sinuses. We have two pericardial sinuses. One is transverse sinus, another one is oblique sinus. So what are these sinuses? So we told that pericardium, after covering the heart, it also encroaches onto the great vessels and then attaches to the adventitia of great vessels. So that is about fibrous pericardium. Serous pericardium also, it lies deep to the fibrous pericardium and encroaches onto the great vessels. So meanwhile, what happens is it forms two tubular structures around the vessels. So how many structures entirely the pericardium is holding? Aorta and pulmonary trunk, superior and inferior vena cava, right pulmonary veins, left pulmonary veins. So this image is after removing the heart. So this is the heart in mediastinum. So I have removed the heart like this. So then in the mediastinum we will see these structures like this. So that is aorta on the right side, pulmonary trunk on the left side, superior and inferior vena cava, right pulmonary veins on one side and left pulmonary veins on other side. So here, this serous layer, one tube is formed surrounding the aorta and pulmonary trunk. So aortopulmonary tube this is. Next, another tube is formed between the remaining great vessels, superior vena cava, inferior vena cava, right pulmonary veins and all the left pulmonary veins. So this is the second serous tube. So between the first serous tube, that is serous tube surrounding aorta and pulmonary trunk and serous tube surrounding remaining vessels, we will see the one deep sac or sinus, that is called transverse sinus. Sinuses are nothing but they are the accumulations of pericardial cavity. In the pericardial cavity only, there are wide spaces. These spaces are called sinuses. So in that, transverse sinus is present between the aorta and pulmonary trunk tube and the tube which is surrounding remaining great vessels. So these two tubes, that is aorta and pulmonary trunk, they pump blood away from the heart. And these tubes, they receive the blood. So this sinus is present between tubes which are pumping blood and tubes which are receiving the blood. This is the transverse sinus. So here, oblique sinus. So where is the oblique sinus present? Oblique sinus present between right veins and the left veins. So right side we have superior vena cava, inferior vena cava and right pulmonary veins, and left side we have left pulmonary veins. And you can see reflection of serous layer from superior vena cava to the left pulmonary vein, and then to the both left pulmonary veins, and then again back to the superior vena cava, covering the right pulmonary veins, inferior vena cava and on the right side of pulmonary veins, and then coming back to the superior vena cava. So there is a small dilated sac here in the pericardial cavity which is present between right veins and the left veins. This is called oblique sinus. Oblique sinus. Now we will talk about the relations of right relations, superior vena cava, inferior vena cava, right pulmonary veins, left relations, left pulmonary veins. And above we have the reflection of serous layer from superior vena cava to the pulmonary veins. And below you can see it is open. It is open and it continues with the rest of the pericardial cavity. Rest of the pericardial cavity. So these sinuses which are present between visceral and parietal layers are important here. So these sinuses, why these sinuses are formed? Because we know during development of heart, so the heart has the four structures like this. It folds on itself. So due to folding on itself, some aspect of pericardial cavity, it is lodged in between. So this is the upper part, lower part of the heart, that is aorta and pulmonary trunk, and these are the ventricles. So when they fold on itself, so some space is formed between. So this space leads to the development of sinuses or formation of sinuses between the structures itself. So so finally we have the applied aspects. So here you can see the 10 applied aspects. First one is pericarditis. You know, as usual, itis means inflammation. So pericarditis means inflammation of the pericardium. So in some bacterial, viral and fungal infections, we will see inflammation of the pericardium. And patients may present usually with the substernal pain, sharp, severe substernal pain. And then second one is pericardial effusion. So because of inflammation, there may be increased accumulation of fluid in the pericardial cavity. So this accumulation of fluid in the pericardial cavity is called pericardial effusion. When this pericardial effusion, it reaches up to 300 ml, the patient will automatically present with breathlessness. So since when he is taking the breathing, he feels difficulty because there is no there is compression of the heart and there is no ventricular filling, and pumping of the blood, all this will be affected. So anyway, pericardial effusion is nothing but accumulation of pericardial fluid in the pericardial cavity. So if that results, that increases to a maximum extent, then we will see the cardiac tamponade. Cardiac tamponade means compression of the heart because of pericardial accumulation or pericardial effusion. So it reached more than 300 ml. Then that pericardial fluid, it compresses on the heart. Why? Because fibrous layer is a very dense non-elastic structure, fibrous pericardium. So it doesn't allow any expansion. So whatever fluid it accumulates, it presses on the heart. It compresses the heart. So automatically, pumping of the blood outside is diminished, and filling of the heart, that is venous return, also decreases, and there will be severe pain and breathlessness from the patient's end. These three features almost result in a fatal condition. So these three symptoms or signs together we call it as a Beck's triad. B-E-C-K, Beck's triad, that is reduced venous return, reduced outflow of from the heart, and severe substernal pain and breathlessness. So this Beck's triad, it is a fatal condition. Then what we will do when there is cardiac tamponade? Patient comes to us with these three symptoms and signs. Then we have to draw the fluid. So we have to remove the extra fluid. That is called pericardiocentesis. Pericardiocentesis. Centesis means removal of fluid, that is drainage of fluid. So drainage of the fluid from the pericardium, this is called pericardiocentesis. And here So this pericardial synthesis, it is usually done from the left side. It is usually done from the left side and near the ziphosternal joint. Near the ziphosternal joint, and at an angle of 45 degrees, we insert the needle into the pericardium under ultrasound guidance. So this should be done under ultrasound guidance. So needle is inserted and the fluid is drawn. So this is called pericardiocentesis, and this fluid we can send it for pathology, that is for to identify whether it is bacterial infection or viral infection. We can also do culture, and sometimes this pericarditis, pericardial tamponade may be due to cancer also. So we can also see if any cancer cells are present in the pericardial fluid. Then hemopericardium. Hemo means blood. When there is accumulation of blood in the pericardial cavity, that is called hemopericardium. This is again another fatal condition, because hemopericardium usually occurs after a trauma, or it may occur due to some rupture of blood vessels, and this leakage of blood will be sudden and severe. So it is very emergency, very great emergency, which results, which is very fatal also. Then pneumopericardium. Pneumo means air. Accumulation of air in the pericardial cavity is called pneumopericardium. Usually after trauma, if there is any pericardial cavity is communicating with that of the outside air, then we will see accumulation of air in the pericardium, that is called pneumopericardium. Then some congenital aspects, that is pericardial cysts. A cyst in the pericardium is called pericardial cyst. So what is a cyst? Encapsulated structure of pericardium. It is encapsulated. Pericardium, part of the pericardium is isolated and it forms, there is a capsule surrounding that. This is the pericardial cyst. Usually this pericardial cysts are present near the right sternocostal margin, or right right aspect, sternopericardial pericardiodiaphragmatic region, right angle of the diaphragm. Here we will see. Next, pericardial diverticula. So you know diverticula. Diverticula means a tube which is prolonged or separated from the main pericardium, and this have continuity with that of the pericardial cavity. So it's just a prolongation from the main surface. So this pericardial diverticula also, sometimes they are seen. They are also seen in the same place. Congenital absence of pericardium. So there is a condition called congenital absence of pericardium, which is very rare. And this condition, if it is present, it may lead to absence of entire pericardium or only partial right or left side of the pericardium. So this occurs during development. So one of the conditions where there is absence of pericardium near the diaphragm, that is central tendon of diaphragm, and this condition is called pentalgia of Cantrell. Pentalgia of Cantrell means it's nothing but the absence of pericardium above the central tendon of diaphragm. So usually it is associated with absence of central tendon of diaphragm also, and some maldevelopment of midline structures. Maldevelopment of midline structures, and there are congenital anomalies of heart also. So these 10 aspects are important applied aspects of pericardium. Pericarditis, pericardial effusion, cardiac tamponade, pericardiocentesis, hemopericardium, pneumopericardium, pericardial cysts, pericardial diverticula, congenital absence of pericardium, pentalgia of Cantrell. Among this, most fatal conditions are cardiac tamponade and hemopericardium. So if you have any doubts, please WhatsApp me. Thank you.